source technology, open data, and mindful development practices. She's a co-founder of Let's Watch TV, the greatest debate of queer characters and shows. She develops software and trials queer representation on television to make the data visible. Without further ado, Mika.
Hi, thank you for coming to a non-Gutenberg talk. The other room is packed wall to wall. Today, I'd like to talk to you about the curious case of a comatose clown. In the world of computer programming, there are two separate but distinct points of view. One is that the cloud is magical and perfect. The other is that it's just a fancy name for servers somebody else owns. The following is a true story of studying performance enhancements gained by using the cloud. No names have been changed to protect the innocent. I'm not going to do the whole talk like that, I promise. Because it is just. Oh. I hate when it does this. All right. Let's start at the beginning of how I came to this wonderful month of October last year where I had a site that was slow. I like to use SVG images whenever humanly possible. I like the motive of font icons, and I love font icons. But SVG can be resized, they can be colored, they can be transformed, and they're relatively small size, so your site's going to run quickly using an SVG image instead of a GIF, or instead of those nice little pixelated images we used to do back in the 90s, and yes, I've been doing websites for that long. I have a library of 700 icons that I happen to use on Let's Watch TV. We don't use all 700 at any one point in time, but we do use quite a lot of them. The overall size is small. The entire library, for example, is less than 2 megs. But each individual image is that big, and it's great. But I don't want to house all of that on the multiple servers we use for the site. I thought, hey, you know what's perfect for this? It's going to be the cloud, right? Part of the reason I decided to put them on the cloud was I thought, well, okay, we're using this library on 6 different servers for 6 different sites we happen to be running. 3 are related to Let's Watch TV, 3 are not. I don't want to copy them out every time I add an image or remove an image or update an image. I'd like to just have one repository, save myself some time. I'm not going to explain how you upload images to the cloud. I'm going to assume that you're all intelligent people who can Google how do I upload images to whatever my cloud is. It was really that simple. There was no extra WordPress-y stuff involved. I just used my SFTP client, and off I went. Now, SVGs aren't images. If you ever tried to upload one to WordPress, you might have noticed you can't. The MIME type is blocked. This is because SVGs are documents. By that, what I mean is that while most of us use them as images, they can be anything. You can open it up, you can edit it like a document. You don't need a visual editor to edit an SVG file. I don't recommend you actually do that unless you know what you're doing. I have made images look like they were drawn by me, and I am not a graphic artist. SVGs work by giving you access to the DOM, which is the Document Object Model. Big fancy term, most of us who use the internet go for a minute, wait a second. What's going on with the DOM? Well, Document Object Model limits the amount of power that you have. You can't edit a file on another server easily. But also, it restricts how much you can do with an image to protect you. Because if an SVG is not just an image, but a document that can do anything, I'd like to prevent it from hurting my users. So by limiting things, we've got a DOM model, separates things. The way to get around this and to let your browser, your CSS, edit an image that's on another site is by embedding your SVG content into a file. So within the regular image, when you put in an image tag, pop it in, off you go. You can do that with an SVG, but as soon as you do that, you can't apply CSS anymore. You can't color it, you can't spin it, you can't do all those wonderful things I want to do. Okay, I'll embed. And if you're using WordPress, you do that with the HTTP API. There's a command called WP remote get. It goes and it gets the file. Their whole name in this case. Outputs So someone once asked me when I was trying to explain why I did this, they said, why didn't you use file get context? That's in PHP, everybody's done that. And I said, because that's actually blocked on a lot of web hosts. You don't want to be able to do a file get content from every server. And in fact, I would like to block people from doing a file get content from every server because I work for a web host and I know firsthand people don't actually know what they're getting when they do that. If they use WP remote get, there are some protections built in already. It makes my life a lot easier. Plus, using the HTTP API from WordPress is actually more reliable. You could replace it with calls like curl or a few other things, but this is going to run on any site that can run WordPress. Because it's got fallbacks, it does all that extra logic that you don't want to have to think about. Now, once you've got the file, you can say, I would like to get the image. And it reaches out and it gets. What happens if the file doesn't exist? Well, WP remote get will throw you an error. So you can check, did I get the image? Okay, great, that's what I want to do. I want to reach out, grab my SVG, pull it in, make an image, check that it exists. Great, let's put it into my content. Off I go to the races. Now, again, you could still use file get contents for this on some servers, but once you've already done that remote get, you can just hang onto it, check the error code, hop onto it, grab all that. It takes about a second, not even really. But once I did all of that, put it on the test server, and I found out something horrible. See, you might have heard of this TV show called The L Word. It's about lesbians, and if you might guess, there are a lot of lesbian characters on that show. And I had a page that was trying to enumerate all of them. About 65 of them at this point in time that have names and lines. That's a lot of characters. And on that specific page, gosh, it was really slow. That page took 13.5 seconds to load on our test server. That's not acceptable. Nobody's going to sit and wait around for a page like that to load. And I said, oh, we have a problem. I turned to Tracy, the woman I work with who makes the site, and I said, your design is great. I've done something horrible. I must figure out why this is slow. We can't go live until it's done. And I had 5 days because we had agreed that was our cutoff date. Okay. 5 days of absolute debugging nightmares. My first step was, okay, what actually is going on here? What is the problem? And I needed to start by looking where I thought it was. So I started checking a number of other pages on the site. And I made a list of which ones took the longest to load. And I used sort of understanding what was going on in general to help make these judgment calls. I knew what the content was on my site. I was aware of what I was building. I was aware of how much data was going to be on each page. And I said, all right, let's load a page that has two characters. Oh yeah, that one loads all right pretty fast. Let's load a page that has 30 characters. Well, hey, this one loads really fast too. What's going on? Let's load this other page, the L word. And we're back to 13 seconds. Trying to find the pattern of what kinds of pages were slow was what led me towards where I was understanding that the problem was I had a list of custom post types on another custom post type page. Think of it this way. I've got 2,000 so odd characters, I've got 900 so odd TV shows, each TV show calls and lists the number of characters, each of which have their own custom post type. Cross-referential data, I got it, that's not slow, I've got my count wrong somewhere. All right, what's another page that's slow? Just to make sure that I'm not crazy. Okay, it's the one with the most back and forth database calls. Here we go, I've got a bad page. That's got to be the problem. Talks called SVGs, it wasn't that problem. So how do you find out what's slow though? I knew it was 13-ish seconds because I was counting it, but that's really an inexact way to figure out what's wrong with your site. So I installed a plugin called Query Monitor, and it showed me slow database queries. It was great. I could read through the number of DD calls. They just updated it yesterday, by the way, or 2 days ago, and it has a beautiful new interface. I love it so much. It looks like I'm just using Inspector on Chrome or on Safari. It blends in perfectly, and it's understandable. It's presented in a way that even someone who's brand new could look at it and go, oh, this thing that's in bright red that says really slow is probably really slow. And that's what you need, because you're looking at so many different aspects of your site while you're trying to debug it. Having Google optimizing your database. I threw in some options. I made WP options table indexable, which is something I don't often recommend someone even consider on their WordPress site, but I happen to have database caching on the server my test site was running on. Let's see if that's related. I started doing all of those things that you always do with a slow database to try to speed it up. I dropped down how many of my drafts I was saving. I turned it off entirely. I made sure that the database was nice and clean. I cleaned out all the plugin options that was left from the prepped of testing. Nothing was helping. In fact, I only managed to get it back down to 10 seconds. But 30 seconds is a fantastic game, by the way. But with 2,000 items to live through, I started to think, well, maybe it's the way that I'm calling SQL that's making this really slow. Because if I'm searching through 2,000 to 3,000 characters, and then I'm only getting about 60-ish back that I need, maybe I should change how I'm doing the loop. Because what I was doing was I said, loop through all the characters. Give me a count of how many characters I've got published. Loop through that many, come out with the answer. Okay, let's step back. What I was doing was inefficient. WP Query has wonderful tools that you can say how many things you're looking for, but what it really says is how many things do I want to get back from this specific result? And I realized, oh, I can make these numbers smaller so that I'm expecting a smaller result. If I know the average number of characters on a show, I can look for that number plus 10 or 20. Okay, let's do a little bit of math. My father's a mathematician, he'd be so proud. Figure out averages, come out, put that in, see if that gets in the game. But it wasn't the TV calls. Because even though I optimized them, and I made them run as fast as humanly possible, it wasn't helping. Okay, it's got to be the number of times I'm doing the calls. Because we're trying to list all the characters, but we're separating them into three separate calls. Regulars, recurring characters, and guests. Clearly, that's why the L word is slow. They've got so many of all of those. Most shows have two or three regulars, five or six recurring, and maybe a dozen guests. And the L word has about 25 each. It's a very special show. It's a great one to use for this example. Okay, so for each group, we said, let's see if this post ID and meta, and let's optimize our query to make that a little bit faster. And that wasn't it at all. In fact, those database calls turned out to be incredibly fast. They weren't even marked as yellow on query monitor, which means, hey, I'm doing this better than I thought I was. Part of this is because I do have a fast database, but also it's because I was using database caching, object caching on the back end. And on top of that, I was telling WordPress to make the kind of queries and searches that WordPress was good at. I was giving it a small amount of data, I was limiting what it was looking for, and I had a fast database, exactly what you're supposed to do. So maybe it was running it three times in a row? Okay, I'm gonna turn off two of the times I'm searching. Let's just get the regular characters. Guess what? It was still just as slow. At this point, I started to think, maybe I'm completely down the wrong route. If nothing I'm doing with the database is giving me any speeds except for what I got from cleaning it up in the first place, I banged my head on the desk a few times, hopped on my bicycle, and went home. I love biking to work. It's great. It lets me kind of reset my brain and stop looking at a screen and then just yell at cars who don't understand how to ride around bicycles. So I went back and I rewrote the query code when I got home. Instead of looking for as many possible posts, I did the limits. I went and cleaned everything up. I reduced duplication as much as possible. I used cache data. I made sure to query things in the most optimal way possible. And it wasn't the volume. Because I went to the